Welcome to Wire Sports. It's Friday the 10th of February. I'm Andy Jackson.
And I'm Stephen Wright.
Coming up, we have a special report on part two of the Wear Tees Derby.
I will have my usual university sports roundup.
Plus, as the Premier League darts got underway yesterday, Micky Welch profiles who to look out for. But first, on Wednesday evening, it was confirmed to us that Fabio Capello had resigned as manager of the England football team. The news came just days following the Italian criticised the Football Association over stripping John Terry as England captain. So with Capello gone, who do you want as the next England manager? Over at iSports.com, we have a live poll on who should be the next manager. And as you can see, Harry Redknapp is firm favourite, while Alan Pardew yesterday ruled himself out of the running. However, you can still vote on the website as our poll will be still running over the weekend. Steve, what did you make of Capello's departure?
I think he's definitely left us in the lurch a little bit with the Euros coming up, but I'm glad to see the back of him, to be honest. He obviously didn't want to be here anymore since the World Cup. So it could be a good thing.
Yeah, and who would you like to see take over?
For me personally, it has to be Harry Redknapp in the long term, definitely. But for right now, for the Euros and the preparation coming up to Euros, it's got to be Gus Hiddink.
It's an interesting call. Anyway, cheers, Steve. On Wednesday, it was the Tees Wear Derby Part 2 as Middlesbrough and Sunderland replayed their FA Cup fourth round tie. However, just what is it like to be a fan of one of those two teams on Derby Day? Well, we took Steve, a Middlesbrough fan, and Sunderland fan Lee Healer to find out.
The last time these two met, the darts wasn't good enough. Unfortunately, it was a draw between Sunderland and Middlesbrough, so it had to be done again. Steve, Middlesbrough fan, what's the score going to be tonight?
1-0 Middlesbrough.
Ooh. Lee, confident?
Oh, yeah, 1-0 Sunderland.
Oh, well, I'll be returning it full-time and half-time to get their opinions.
The match is about to kick off. The lads are ready and waiting for a tense match.
Cool, bro, lads!
Oh, God's sake, Yusuf's first touch.
Oh, you want to speak John O'Shea? The man's not played a game in so long now. He doesn't even know what a football is.
Shoot,
no,
shoot!
No.
Oh, what a goal! That was a great goal.
So we're currently at half time and it's Sunderland 1, Middlesbrough 0. Could have been 1-1 when Middlesbrough had a shot cleared off the line. It's been a cagey game, but that's what you expect for such an important derby game. Steve, disappointed?
I'm very annoyed, yeah. I think we had more chances, but to be fair, their goal was really good. Hopefully we can get one back.
I do think Middlesbrough do have a great chance. This one goal seems to have spurred them on, so hopefully the game will open and there'll be more chances. Lee, what do you think the score's going to be?
I think it'll actually just be 1-0. I think the chances we've had are just, well, there hasn't been that many. I think they've definitely had more chances, but I think the goal we've had is, well, I think it was a shock actually because it was against a runner play as well.
Well, it's 1-0 at the minute. I'll return at full time.
Duke! Yes!
Oh my God.
1-1! Justin!
Oh.
My God, man! Get him off the field! he's a liability!
Oh, I've gone in.
God, sir, I thought he put it in his own net then.
Oh, come on, what was that?
Sunderland and Middlesbrough have played over 180 minutes, but we still don't have a winner. It's currently 1-1, so that means extra time. There's 30 minutes of extra time, and if they don't score then it's down to penalties. So, fingers crossed.
No, I'm Wickham, man.
21st minute, aren't we?
Yes.
So there you have it. After extra time, Sunderland win 2-1. What do you think, Steve? How are you feeling?
Bit devastated to go out, to be honest. I thought we deserved to at least take it to penalties. I think we're the better team with more chances, but what are you going to do? They had that one quality player, and he showed.
You definitely did have better chances throughout the game. You have youth team, though, a lot of youth players. How important is it to have youth and local team?
I'm very proud. Out of 11 players on the field, 9 of them were from Middlesbrough. So, at the end of the day, I think it shows a lot of pride for our area, if nothing else.
You can definitely take a lot from that game. Lee, 2-1, Arsenal next game.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough game, but I think even today was a really tough game, actually, as well. So, I think if we play, well, actually, if we play like that against Arsenal, I can't say it's going any further, but if we play a lot better, but with today's performance, I think we just have to take it and say, yeah, we won, and get on with the next game.
So there you have it from a very happy Sunderland household, 2-1 to Sunderland.
So it will be Sunderland who face Arsenal in the FA Cup next week. Sorry, Steve. Anyway, now it's time for your sporting news from the week. Tottenham manager Harry Redknapp has been cleared of all charges of tax evasion. The Spurs manager said following the trial that the last 5 years had been a nightmare for him.
Kenny Dalglish says he wants a line to be drawn under the Luis Suarez affair ahead of their game against Manchester United this Saturday. This weekend will most likely be the first time Suarez will play against United since he received his 8-match ban for racially abusing Patrice Evra. Staying with United, it's been confirmed today that Ryan Giggs has signed a 1-year contract extension, which is taking him to 22 years of service at the football club.
Remember, you can leave your thoughts on anything we have discussed today or will discuss, or if you want to comment on my nice new shirt, tweet us at iSports, like us on Facebook or go to iSports.com.
It's a glorious shirt, Andy.
All right, thank you, Steve. Anyway, in other news, England's cricketers were whitewashed in the Test series against Pakistan. They lost by 71 runs in the final Test following the game, and Ian Bell has been dropped from the one-day squad after amassing just an average of 8.5 runs over the series.
Amir Khan has confirmed the date for his rematch against Lamont Peterson. Khan will fight the American on the 19th of May at Las Vegas' Mandalay Bay Hotel after the first match took place in Peterson's hometown of Washington, D.C. Peterson won the WBA and IBF light welterweight titles in controversial fashion last December.
Phil Taylor came from 6-1 down against Adrian Lewis to draw 7-7 on the opening night of the Premier League darts in Manchester. The Power will be looking to take home his 6th Premier League darts trophy. But who else are the contenders in this year's championship? Micky Welch is in the pod with his players profile.
Well, it's that time of year again. It's a return of the Premier League darts. It actually kicked off last night in Manchester and it's going to continue every Thursday for the next 15 weeks. We thought here on iSports we'd give you a little profile on each of the players. So if you haven't already picked your favourite to follow, then maybe this can help you out. Now, first up, we're going to be looking at last year's champion, Gary Anderson. Now, Gary blew away everybody in the competition last year because he had some astonishing performances and he won it in his debut season. His form of late has been up and down, so he'll be hoping to prove a few doubters wrong about his one-hit wonder tag. Next up, we've got current world champion Adrian Lewis. Now, he's known as the Jackpot and he's actually won back-to-back world championships. Now, that, in my opinion, establishes him as the one to beat. He's also just won the World Cup of Darts for England alongside our next competitor, and that just happens to be 15 times world champion Phil the Power Taylor. Now, by his own standards, Phil would admit that last year he did have a year to forget. He was knocked out of the World Championships early doors, but the World Cup win, you never know, that could spur him on to make 2012 another trophy-laden year. Now, fourth of the eight players is Simon Whitlock. Now, he's from Australia and he's had ankle and feet problems over the last 18 months. But displays in his last few TV tournaments are showing that he's actually getting back to his best. He is, after all, the beard to be feared. Well, some in our studio, namely Andy Jackson, may say that that's a beard to be admired. Now, the next player up is James Wade. James will once again be strutting his stuff on our screens. He's won a few majors in his time, but let's be honest, over the last couple of years, he's been below par. Hopefully, his off-screen problems that he's had are getting sorted, so you never know, he may be back to some true form. Next up, Raymond van Barneveld. Barney is the only other overseas representative. He's a Dutch legend and he's got like a really natural and fantastic throw. But the only thing that lets Barney down is his temperament at times. His body language, dropping his head, and that allows opponents to take over and pounce and take advantage. Now, he does have one thing on his side, Barney, and that is massive support no matter where he goes in the UK, and that extends to our studios as well. Stephen Wright, the other presenter on the show, is a massive fan. Now, we've got a couple of debutants for you. We've got first up Andy Hamilton. Now, Andy was a runner-up at the World Championships. He's known as the Hammer, as I say, and he showed some unbelievable class and performances a lot of people didn't think he was capable of. Now, one thing is for sure, if you are playing Andy in a game, you know that you are going to be up against it because he will fight for every single point. Now, finally making up the eight competitors, we've got Daventry-based Kevin Painter. Daventry, by the way, regular viewers will know this, is the hometown of our very own Ash Bevan. Now, the artist guaranteed his wildcard pick when he won the Players' Championship last year. Now, to be fair, he's shown some real class and real form that we haven't seen from him in the past 10 or so years. That's the lineup. No doubt over the next 3.5 months, we'll be bringing you darts features and reports on iSports and on iSports.com. Who do you think will win? Why don't you send us a message at iSports on Twitter? If you're asking me who I think will win, look no further than two-time world champion AD Lewis. It's in the bag. Back to you, lads.
Now it's time for university sport. This week's feature game is men's hockey, and as Steve describes, it was a good day for Sunderland.
Sunderland's men had an easy game this week in hockey as they convincingly won 4-0 against Leeds Metropolitan. They were constantly a threat from corners and Leeds had a serious issue trying to get past the Wearsiders' defence, this being one of their better chances that was easily dealt with. Sunderland, in contrast, threatened from start to finish, this point scored by Duncan Stephen. This leaves Sunderland second in the books table.
In men's volleyball, Sunderland recorded their first win of the campaign as they beat York St John comfortably 3-0. This is the perfect way to come back after a disappointing exit to the books in the Bucks Cup last week. The win leaves them fourth in the table with 0 points and 12 points from the top. Unfortunately, results elsewhere not so great as Sunderland's third team lost in football to York's thirds. The score was 3-1 in favour of the visitors and there was some controversy as Sunderland conceded a questionable penalty when they were 1-0 up, which completely changed the game. It was an equally bad week for men's badminton as they were beaten by table toppings Hull 6-2. Unfortunately, this still leaves the Wearsiders in the relegation zone, but we'll play fellow strugglers York St John next Wednesday.
Now it's time for some sporting previews. Sunderland host Arsenal at the Stadium of Light this Saturday. The Black Hats will just score 4 points behind the Gunners with a win, but Martin O'Neill will still be without Nicholas Bendtner and Wes Brown, but could welcome back Lee Cattermole.
It's a North London versus North East extravaganza this week as Newcastle travel to Tottenham on Saturday in the late game. It'll be a difficult game for the Magpies with Spurs flying high, but Alan Pardew's men have been in decent form ahead of the game. The double Denver delight demolished Aston Villa, but hopefully we'll do the same tomorrow.
Definitely. Middlesbrough will be looking to move a step closer to the Championship's top two with a win against Ipswich this weekend. Early in the season, the teams drew 0-0, but Tony Mowbray's men will be looking for victory on Saturday. Middlesbrough have not won in the Championship since Boxing Day.
Weather permitting in League One, Hartlepool play Bournemouth at Victoria Park. While in Conference, Gateshead play Bath and Darlington host the second in the table, Wrexham, at the Arena.
That is all for this week, but remember our radio show is back this Monday on 107 Spark FM and you can keep up to date on all the latest sporting news by following at iSports on Twitter, liking us on Facebook or going to iSports.com. Thanks for watching this week. We will see you again next week. Take care.